What I am intending to talk in this very brief session is about issues of Millennium Development Goals and issues of inclusiveness, peace and security, and accountability, how important these issues will be in the post-2015 Millennium Development Goal agendas for Africa. I'm saying post-2015 because we are almost close. Left with only about 2 years in the Millennium Development Goal agendas. That's going to be 2015. The MDGs were an important goals because they were mostly focused in tackling disease, poverty, and addressing those who were disadvantaged and stricken by poverty. Because of that, these were important goals. And I'm not repeating it. I'm not going to repeat that because I strongly believe most of you have been having interactions with these issues in several instances. Probably you are more eloquent than myself about those issues. But I have to say some of these things again to make my points. And I'm more interested in saying few things about the challenges rather than restating what has been stated already. The African Union as the regional organization, as a successor of the OAU, has certain objectives and principles that it is guided by. And those objectives and principles are important for the attainment of the MDGs and the envisioned development agenda post-2015. As you know, and as you probably, many of you probably were part of it, there were several sessions and events taking place towards determining what should be the vision of Africa in post-2015. The African Union, among other things, has certain objectives at encouraging international cooperation, taking account of the Charter of the United Nations and the Universal Declaration, promote peace, security, and stability in the continent, promote democratic principles and institutions, popular participation and good governance, promote and protect people's rights. These are some of the African Union's core objectives. And the principle it is guided by also include respecting the rights of member states and also intervention in issues of peace and stability, promoting gender equality, promotion of self-reliance, promotion of social justice, respect sanctity of human life, and condemnation and rejection of impunity. These were some of its central principles. So what I'm interested in those principles and objectives, the reason I'm interested in those principles and objectives is how has in the MDGs over the last period has the African Union and its predecessor been dealing with those issues in Africa? So far, we can see that there are certain level of commitments by African governments. And also, there were certain achievements in line with targeted goals with the African with the Millennium Development Program. We can see that the substantial progress was attained in many countries in a number of areas, like school enrollment programs, access to education has been one of the areas where certain developments were recorded in the African continent with regards to the MDG. Certain countries have also registered some impressive development in certain goals, but not in all of them. With some indicators, like in the areas of universal primary education, HIV/AIDS, and some areas of mental health, there were some developments, but there were also challenges. challenges that have been faced. So as part of this process, the African governments have been taking several initiatives, some of them, for instance, allocating or putting a cut-off budget of a certain percentage of their budget, for instance, to education, some of them to health, some of them to agriculture, and making some progress towards attaining these objectives. But the problems were not easy. There were several challenges. While talking about access to education, quality has remained a challenge. While talking about improvements in access to education, gender parity has still remained a challenge. Not only gender parity, but also there are some disadvantaged groups. If you look into our own continent and our own countries, there are some groups who still were not enjoying equally the benefits. And social inequity was one aspect of the challenges that has been taking in the implementation of the development, Millennium Development Programs in Africa. So because of this, we can see that the African Union, the African Union has been working on that and looking into the post-2015 era and has set certain prioritized four broader areas as its vision for the post-2015 Millennium Development Agenda issues or Development Agenda issues. One area that has identified is structural economic transformation and inclusive growth. This is one area identified as one broader dimension for the post-2015 development agenda. The second one is innovation and technology transfer. It is believed that technology use of technology would transform the challenges and problems in Africa to the benefit of the broader African society, and that would contribute also human development. So third major broader development outcome identified for the post-2015 was the human development aspect. And finally, financing and partnership. So the African Union has identified these four broader areas for the post-2015 development agenda in Africa. However, that you have structural economic transformation and inclusive growth is one aspect. Innovation and technology transfer is another. Human development is another. But there are also certain issues that must not be overlooked. And I think in its post-2015 draft document, the African Union has identified some issues which are important to pay due attention to. I think these are some of the gaps in previous times. And I'm happy to see that these were identified as enablers of development. The African Union has identified now what it calls, besides placing these four broad development indicators, has also identified some areas as enablers of the development, that these are critical and key for if these broadly defined indicators are to be attained in post-2015. So one was peace and security. Peace and security is seen as an important enabler to attainment of the development agendas. Second one is good governance, transparency, and fighting corruption. And the third one is promoting equality and access to justice. Fourth, human rights for all. And fifth is gender equality. And I think these are probably very important from an African perspective. Because Africa has a problem with peace and stability. There are some countries which have a good and stable governance system, but also there are fragile systems. There are emerging conflicts. In some places, where past challenges of instability, civil war, internal disputes were thought to be an over agenda, but now there are some countries falling back into those problems of instability and conflict, and that's affecting the poorest, the poor and the poorer segment of the society, because Africa is predominantly a small-scale economy continent. And then conflict, instability affects those who doesn't have the means and the resource for at their disposal. So peace and security is a key element. Governance, transparency, and fighting corruption. Corruption is I guess, a major challenge. Is a major challenge in Africa. I would say it is a problem in my country. I mean, as a citizen, I would say it's an emerging, it's a problem coming to affect our very Ethiopian values and also affecting the poor. This is, I assume a problem in many other places in the continent. And the ratings of some indicators in this regard showing there was a study by a Tanzania-based organization about situation of corruption in Ethiopia. There was a survey, and it indicates that the problem is not that easy, and it needs serious attention. So, if development is to be attained, this is one major problem that needs to be carefully scrutinized and addressed. Equality and access to justice, again, similarly, an issue that deserves serious attention. Human rights for all. I mean, if we are to speak honestly and straightforward, still human rights violation is a recurring problem in Africa. I mean, you can look into the regional organization's impressive works towards promoting and protecting human rights. However, the problem still remains to be a challenge. Gender equality, I mean, Madam has been making an excellent statement on that. Gender equality is still an issue sought to be attained in Africa. So if these are what we have to consider in the post-2015 development agendas in Africa, structural economic transformation and inclusive growth, innovation and technology transfer, human development, financing and partnership. And the enablers are peace and security, good governance, transparency, fighting corruption and accountability, promoting equality and access to justice, human rights for all, and gender equality. Are we in a position to attain those issues? That is the question. We agree that development and stability, development and equality go hand in hand. Equity and social justice go hand in hand with development. If it is a development that doesn't benefit the larger group, and if it's not going to relieve the poorest from the level of their living, and then that's not going to be development. There is a serious issue for narrowing the gaps. But I think that's not actually the case now. So what are the challenges for the African Union to take the development agendas in the post-2015 period? One challenge will be that it has fragile countries and emerging conflicts. Okay, continuing threat of instability and lack of peace and security that we are observing it at Mali, Central African Republic, South Sudan, just a young country that has just emerged a few years ago, but slip on into a challenging situation. Unconditional change of government is another challenge. I mean, development is difficult to think without stability, without stable governance system. Inequity and marginalization of vulnerable groups is another problem. You know, a nation might have, if you look at this, if some of you were to Addis 10 years ago, I'm sure you will have a different picture of Addis today. Does that mean all residents and citizens have benefited equally? No, we shouldn't be misled by this glaring infrastructures. Yes, that is a development. That is part of our gains and attainment. But also, we shouldn't be taken over by this and forget the poor. Behind the glaring skyscrapers, we have people who are not guaranteed of their tomorrow. That is an issue that we have equity, and addressing problems of marginalization is an important. This is Africa is a country of diverse culture and diverse groups. A continent of diverse cultures and diverse groups. And there are marginalizations and discriminations based on certain societal relations and also other forms of marginalization, minority groups, indigenous communities. All this should be taken account of in our development endeavors in Africa. Again, there is also an emerging problem. If friends, if you have probably similar view to me or not, or against, I do think in Africa there is a tendency of narrowing the space for civil society. Narrowing the space for civil society. Different voice. I think we are a society that is diverse. So we cannot always be of one and similar voice. There are different voices. And there must be ways of airing those voices. I think there are some African nations are more and more inclined into being too legalistic in dealing with the civil society, and then ended up narrowing the space for the civil society. That's a concern that has to be taken into consideration while thinking about development agendas in Africa and the African Union's role in that. Corruption is, again, to stay a challenge. Ongoing human rights violations and problems of accountability. Impunity is enemy to rule of law and equality. So the challenge to accountability is one of the problems. So for the African Union, as an organization that is based on the principles of promotion of gender equality, peace and security, self-reliance, respect for sanctity of human life, and condemnation of rejection of impunity, this will be the challenges. This will be the challenge in its endeavor in the post-2015 development agenda. So we have to be vigilant about these issues, in my view, and that dealing and working towards that on that along that line will contribute in creating a better Africa based on equality and social justice, and a better tomorrow for ourselves and for our children. That's my point. So let's focus on the challenges. The challenges are not so easy. Probably many of them are easier said than done. But it is really a serious issue to take account of. Environmental challenge is another problem. While in some African countries, while drawing foreign direct investment as part of the initiatives to strengthen the economy, there are some groups who are probably being forgotten or marginalized as a result. That environment is not taken into account. Some local communities are disregarded in the development endeavors. Development always has its own side issues that, unless you take them carefully, unless you consider them carefully, could result in affecting other while enriching the other. So these issues must be taken into consideration carefully and faithfully, so that development will benefit all. And the future of Africa can be much more brighter than it is now. Africa is believed to be in the right path in dealing with disease, poverty, inequality, but the problems and the challenges are still immense. That's my brief input. And if we have interactions, I will be happy. Thank you for listening to me and giving me the opportunity.
Your presentation is quite various pieces of results. I want to take you back on the issue of the Millennium Development Goal. There was a paper I presented to the University of Brandon about 2010. I'll give it to you.
Okay, thanks.
You talked about budget, to be specific. I had raised in my presentation about the need for African countries to revisit the damage of the structural adjustment program in the 1980s. In comparative terms to the lessons of the current recession and matters arising from Greece and Portugal, you cannot build something on nothing. There was a damage of the structural adjustment program by mainstream financial institutions. They encourage Africa to embark on very large projects. They discourage micro activities for very selfish reasons. And one of the guests there was an advisor to the World Bank at that time. He didn't answer me, he dodged it. And at the end I caught him saying I was very cynical. But we talked at the end of the day. Now, let us give an example of what's happening in Congo. To attain a Millennium Development Goal is not something that you fix to 2015. We talked about structural economic transformation based on the parameters of the application of laws, of policies and institutions as directed by the United Nations and to the instruments of the World Bank, the IMF and the Paris Club. They have not told us, they have not accepted that what they introduced to us in the 1980s has actually failed us. We need to revisit it, because in Greece today the courts have been, there have been a lot of anger about it. Then you talked about inclusive growth. Whose growth? You talked about technological transfer. Nobody gives you the technology to patent when he leaves off the trading of that technology. We need to buy electronics, we need to buy cars, we need to actually do lots of things. Human development aspect of it, yes. A lot of people are schooling. They are being informed, but is it the right education that you are being imparted on? We talked about financing. What sort of finance? Who gets the bulk of the finance? Who are those consulting for some of these aids that come in? Then you also talked about African Union identifying gaps. We've identified gaps since 50 years ago. The gaps are always there. And if you look at what is happening in Congo, it's pathetic. Central African Republic, South Sudan, I carried a conflict vulnerability assessment of South Sudan last 2 years. And my focus was on the role of external factors in the conflict situation, right from Abiye to other parts of South Sudan. When John Garang died, the African Union did not raise questions surrounding the death of John as a matter of economic, social, strategic, and security interest. The cycle continues. Sudan is in trouble. A new nation of less than 2.5 years or 3 years. Peace and security. What is peace? Tying it to economic imperatives and strategic national interest of developed countries that have the permanent statute to decide where to go to war and where not to go to war. In the period of recession, right from the great time of the Great Depression, we know that countries depend on war to end their living. The African Union should know that there's something happening that they also have not been able to voice out, and I don't know why. The lead role of France in Mali and now Central African Republic, they had information about this coming. I've seen lots of write-ups about impending crisis in Mali and South Sudan. The intervention came after the damage has been done. The question is, economic reason, strategic national interest, I don't know. Now, also, we've always talking about good governance. No governance in the world is good. The Tea Party, the Democrat government in America is a mess. So we need to also understand that other countries of the world have their own challenges, so that we will not be living in that defeatist tendency that nothing good can come out of Africa and where our governance is bad. We are learning, but we are tired of learning. Now, the question is, you asked one question, my last contribution is, are we in a position to attain the MDG goal? I have two answers for you. Yes.
Okay.
And no.
It's interesting.
Yes. If we agree to look back into the mistakes of the past, come back around the table and say we messed up, we need to revisit and let people discuss about how SAP destroyed Africa. We had so many companies, textile companies in Canada. What were the conditionalities? Farming was subsidized during the period of SAP in America and even in Britain. Up till now, farmers have been paid for their land. What conditionalities to Africa would that stop subsidizing agriculture? We will provide you with food. And how do we pay for those foods? Raw products or end product? I'm a great critic of the African Union. Good style, but substance is lacking. We are not telling ourselves the truth. 2015 MDG target is a need. I'm sorry, if you want me to expatiate more, I have my records and analysis. You are a professor, and you know in the academics, it's about argument and discussion. We are afraid to argue, but argument brings us to life. So those questions have been posed to you. And we also know the role of INGs in Sudan. This might not be the right place for us to actually begin to go deeply into it. The Ethiopia question, yes, so many infrastructures, but the trickling down effect is very little. Who is actually taking the puck?
I will say three things in follow up on what my brother said. Also want to join him in registering my concern that we may not be able to achieve the Millennium Development Goals, even though we pretend that, I would say that almost all countries are getting towards that. And I also want to say that what you've raised as enablers, which African Union have identified, may also not be achieved simply because of one critical issue, governance issue in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
We will pretend that we are creating solutions for all these problems, but if you look at the conflict in South Sudan today, it's a governance issue. We can't pretend that we have, it's generated by communities.
Yes, indeed. To some degree, MDG can be achievable somehow in sports. But systemizing the strategy to the grassroots, as we said. And that's why, if you will kindly note what Nigeria is trying to do, we're taking the message to the grassroots in our local languages. With A, you want to think about what they have, places where establishment that you can have, dissemination of information, gathering data, measurement of impacts for continuity of the system. That's what we're trying to do. If you will take it, it's not a Nigerian matter. We did it, that those who wish we used to have it. Somebody asked quickly that what is it mentally about? I'll just mention, yes, ma'am, from Kenya. What we're trying to do in Nigeria to get the message across to her, what to have a national curriculum for civics, ethics, and mentorship. I think our political leaders need to understand what it is now. We're driving very seriously in Nigeria. We're having a special conference for that. But fine, but I think what's our business here in listening to you on ethics and RCD? We believe, according to the definition, universal understanding, heavenly understanding of ethics, that the absence of character is the beginning of all crisis. Therefore, the absence of ethics is the beginning of all these lamentations we have enumerated. Disregard for human rights and the stifling of the space and so on and so forth, it's all out of unethical leadership. Ethical, unethical understanding of political leadership and governance or democracy. Therefore, and then again, please note, talking of value, your fellow academia is talking. Mm-hmm. But what do we Africans do with our people from the diaspora? Talking of the transfer of knowledge and sharing of technology. Mm-hmm. Our people have been there somewhere 30, 40, 50 years. They've added value for themselves. Another thing is for African leaders to appreciate and find a way of creating the reintegrational strategies. What do we do with our diaspora outside? What do Indians do with their diaspora? What do the Jews do with their diaspora? What do you people do with your people in the diaspora? These are the issues we have to raise, and I hope it's going to be taken up. And I will support you. Believe me, I will talk to the Deputy Commissioner, the sister lady, doctor from Nigeria. This and this is what we have said. I want to see action. Positive assertion by AU. Even Nepal, I don't know whether I mentioned anything about Nepal here. Has Nepal been a success?
No.
Please note it. Right? And IMF, World Bank. The last time there was, I know the IMF man said, they were sick. He was sick and tired of bureaucracies and all that legalistic stuff. He said, action, and repeated this. I think that was in Japan, something like that. So if that is the way some people are beginning to feel, to understand this global situation or messes that we're talking about. But for us is to say, people sympathize with us, we should sympathize with ourselves and get into action. You are there, we'll talk to you. We want to see the action of your paper and how you are correcting the unethical treatment of the human rights issues, gender inequalities, etc., etc. Every mess we're talking about is because we refuse to accept ethics as a foundation, indispensable word for the humanity to utilize for the good of the human species. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. So, thank you all. I mean, I knew it, I came to learn than to give, so I have learned it. That's the first thing. But finally, I would say a few statements, and as a follow-up to what you've said already, my African brothers have already said it, that I think the answer must be a homegrown one. The solution should be homegrown. That's not to be questioned. Structural adjustment, globalization, meant several initiatives, aid conditionalities, international financial institutions, all this have the contribution, but also the negative or the downsides as well. Forgetting cultural diversity, local institutions, local solutions, local knowledge, indigenous knowledge. That I think has to be taken as and to be admitted as a matter of fact. So, yes and no, MDG will be attained, yes and no. I may also join you in that point, friend over there. But I think the genuine political commitment, not a political commitment in the form, but also in the actual. That is, the actual and the perceived must match. I guess the problem is there is a mismatch between the actual and the perceived. So between the form and the content, there is a mismatch in real life in the continent. That has to be addressed. We have to be genuine when we talk about accountability. The AU has to be genuine enough when it talks about it will not promote impunity. It is going to challenge impunity. Let me add to you. You have pointed a very good point. many of the conflicts probably are not do not have their roots inside Africa. And there was an author, if you like to read, who has done research in Somalia, and she talked about how foreign aid has crippled agriculture in Somalia, and how the UN agenda for peace and its investment has contributed to Somalia's instability. So we have to look at it also from that angle as well. We shouldn't be placing the blame on others only. We have to take our own due share, and our organizations should be stand to be corrected and criticized, because that is where change and development comes from. And we have to liberate ourselves from this growing intolerance of different views and hating alternative voice, stifling the space. That has to be addressed. That is, and still, the answer is, should be homegrown. That's what I can say. And thank you all for your contributions. I have learned a lot.